Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
All right, so should we start? Any questions from last class or classes before that? I think. So we have posted your first assignment online. You guys can access course website. So there we have posted this assignment, which will be due on 1st of November. You can just mail your assignment to Yoke and just put, you know, as a subject, just put assignment number one. Okay. Okay, so in last class we studied two classification algorithms. One was naive Bayes algorithm, another was very, like, you know, sort of basic and intuitive algorithm called K nearest neighbor or KNN. And so in this class also we'll study two more classification algorithms, and if time permits we'll go to a clustering algorithm. And the reason why we are, you know, giving you this bunch of algorithms beforehand is that later when we go to some, you know, general techniques, you can then, you know, try to figure out that, okay, this is how this algorithm fits in the broad scheme of things. Okay, so let's recall k nearest neighbor algorithm. So suppose you have a bunch of points, let's say positives and negatives. Okay, so k nearest neighbor algorithm, what it will do is, suppose you are given a test point, I want to figure out for this point what is its label, whether it is positive or negative, right? So what I'll do is I'll figure out, let's say, k closest points to this point. Let's say k is equal to 3. So these three are my closest points, and I'll take a voting amongst these three nearest neighbors. Like, what is the majority, whether the majority is positives or negatives. Okay. So one big issue with this algorithm is that, suppose, you know, at test time, I have to figure out for this point what is its class. And let's say I have 1 billion test training points. So what I'll have to do is I'll have to, you know, compute distance to every single point in my training set, compute the distances, and then sort the distances, and then take k nearest neighbors and take their voting, right? So the running time will be just huge, and you just cannot use it in, you know, real life systems. So is there any simple heuristic or simple approximation to get around it? So Johnson and Strauss will only help you get down to a low dimensional space. So suppose if you are in very high dimensional space, you'll just get down to a, let's say if you have n training points, then you'll get down to log n training point dimensional space. But that still doesn't relieve you of this issue that you have to compute distance to every single point. Sure, the distance is in low dimensional space now, but you have to compute this distance. And furthermore, I mean, this looks, theoretically it looks nice that you can do this Johnson and Strauss, but in practice, for several data sets, you'll face severe issues. I mean, the distortion that it will give you in the distances, because it cannot preserve distance as it is, it will give you distortion. The distortion can be much larger than your actual distances, and that will be a big problem. One second.
When you say distortion, what do you mean?
So I'll tell you. So Johnson and Strauss, what it guarantees is that, let's say, for all your points, xi minus xj times this projection, that is r times xi minus xj, is less than 1 plus delta xi minus xj, and then greater than equal to 1 minus delta xi minus xj. Okay. So this delta is your distortion. So this is your projection to low dimensional space. Yeah. Sure. for all ij, r times xi minus xj, 2 num square, let's say, is less than 1 plus delta. And then greater than 1 minus delta. So if you go to log n by delta square dimensions, then you can guarantee, so basically which means that this r is in your r to power log n by epsilon square multiplied by d, where d is your dimensionality of each data point, that is xi belongs to r to power d for all I. Okay, so this will say that this r times xi is a log n by epsilon square dimensional point, and distance between any two such projections will be less than this and greater than or equal to this. So there will be certainly some distortion. And issue is that this distortion can be very fatal in several applications. So suppose your nearest guy is very close, and there are several such guys. And if some of the, let's say just one such guy, and then all others are almost at the same distance. So this distortion in that one single point can, you know, change your entire prediction. Okay. So that is the issue.
The outlier effects.
Yeah, outlier effect will be there. And also it's just that, let's say for a given point only, I have just one point which is reasonably close to it, and all other points are far away. So I'm very reliant on this point and distance to this point. And if that distance is distorted heavily, I might be in trouble. Okay. So, the bottom line is, so one is that there is distortion. Second point is that still I have to compare against all my n training points. So still, like if you have a billion data points, it will be prohibitively expensive. So what is the remedy? So there is one simple heuristic that you can do, or like approximation, that rather than computing distance to all, like, you know, points in my training set and then taking the vote, what I'll do is I will approximate all my positive points by their mean. Okay? And similarly, I'll approximate all my negative points by their mean. Okay? So essentially, I have just collapsed all my positive points into one single point. I have collapsed all my negative points into one single point. And then I do my one nearest neighbor classification. That is, my classification function will be something like this. It will be sine of mu I minus x square minus mu plus minus x square. Where mu plus is 1 by number of positives, so n plus is your number of positives, times all the points such that your label is plus 1, xi, and then mu I is 1 over n minus okay. So recall, I mean, just for notational sake, I am given this training data x1, y1, so on till xn, yn, and each yi belongs to minus 1, 1, and let's say each xi belongs to r to power d. Okay. So this is the mean of my positives, this is the mean of my negatives. So if distance of point x to mean of negatives is larger than distance of x to positives, then I will say that, okay, x is a positive point. I'll assign positive label to x. And if distance to positives is more, then I'll assign x the negative label. Okay. So essentially, what we are doing is we are just collapsing all positive points into one, all negative points into one, and then doing nearest neighbor classification. Okay. So let's understand this decision boundary a little bit more. Yeah.
So why is it the case that in all models we are assuming that the points are always separated by a plane or something? Like, why can't it be like the plus points are all inside the ones?
We'll just by the end of this lecture I'll try to address that issue.
No, like, always choose our features differently such that this is avoided. I mean, like,
no, you, I mean,
like, for example, in this specific scenario where all points inside unit radius is plus and outside is minus,
yeah,
I will change my feature to be like the radius of this, and then
precisely,
then I can separate.
Then you can separate. So, So basically the issue is that, okay, the points are separable in some space, but they are not linearly separable.
Yeah.
And we'll come to that, okay, if the points are not linearly separable, what all can you do to address that issue? So just wait till the end of the lecture. But here, I mean, we haven't even talked about separability or anything. We are just talking at very intuitive level. We are saying that, okay, if I'm close to positives, I'll assign it to be positive label. If I'm on an average, if I'm close to negatives, I'll assign it a negative label. And I'll assign the point a negative label. Okay? And let's look at the decision function. So this decision function is sine of, so this is mu I minus square plus x square minus twice x inner product with mu minus mu plus square minus x square, then plus twice x comma mu plus, right? And this I can write as, so this x square goes away. And this will look like something like twice mu minus inner product with x plus mu minus square minus mu plus square. Okay, so this looks like essentially sine of a hyperplane where I have W inner product with X plus B. Okay, so this W represents, so you guys are familiar with this, right? So this is a hyperplane where W represents normal to the hyperplane and B represents distance of origin to the hyperplane. That is, so the W is normal to my hyperplane, and let's say my origin is somewhere here. So this is not to draw it perpendicular. So, and this is B, okay? So this is my hyperplane WX plus B. And now what I'm saying is that all the points that are on this side of hyperplane, they are positive because I'm taking sine of this WX plus B. And all the points that are on this side of hyperplane, they are negative. Okay. Is that clear? All right. So what is it saying? That this classifier or this decision function that I have is essentially a hyperplane-based classifier, where this hyperplane W is given by twice mu plus minus mu minus, and then this distance to origin, that is this bias B, is given by mu minus mu plus square. So if we draw it on this picture, how does it look? How does my decision function look? So let's say this is my mu minus, this is my mu plus. I connect them, okay? So this will be, this vector is essentially mu minus in this direction. This is my, so this vector is normal to my hyperplane. So this is my hyperplane, okay? And this point is mu plus mu minus by 2. That is, it takes average of these two points and I draw a hyperplane through it, which is perpendicular to these connectors, okay? Which intuitively also makes sense, right? That now all the points that are on this side, they are closer to mu plus, so I'll assign them positive. All the points that are on this side, they are negative. I'll assign them, sorry, they are closer to mu minus, and I'll assign them negative label. Okay. So what are the, sure, so this is well and good, but this classifier is almost never used in practice. It's very limited. So like, what are sort of main limitations?
The spread is not considered in those two pluses and minuses.
I mean, so why do I...
Separation is always the big point of the two views.
Yeah.
So the one cluster may be more dispersed over the other.
Uh-huh.
So it doesn't...
That can be an issue. But I can, what I can do is I can try out all the, like, you know, bias values. I can take this hyperplane and try to shift it through everything to take care of that issue a little, like up to some extent, right? But still, that is also not powerful enough. Size of cluster is not considered, but what I can do is I can try to move them around, right? And still at least tackle that issue a little bit.
You can have multiple clusters. Minus.
Yeah, so that is one issue, that you can have multiple clusters. Give me 1 second. Let's see.
Hi, Prateek. Hi. Am I audible? I think there will be a delay of 10 seconds or something. So yes. In the video, it won't be audible.
Yes. So go ahead with your question. In the meantime, let me. So, this is very awkward. So the
center point is like mu plus mu minus by 2, right?
Yeah.
And also one problem could be that the perpendicular might not be the actual solution.
Yeah. So main thing is that here we have fixed our direction of the hyperplane, and that might not be a good case always. So let's consider a simple example.
It could be another angle.
Yeah, precisely. Well, he'll hear it 10 seconds later. So let's consider this type of case. So suppose you have points here, and then points here. So let's say these are positives, these are negatives, and these are negatives, right? So mean of these positive points will be something like this. This will be my mu plus. Mean of these points will be something like mu minus, right? And then my classifier will be something like this. Okay? So it will have this much of error for sure. This error and these points are definitely misclassified, right? So I'll have around 25% error. Whereas if I would have selected something like this, this is my separator. That is, all the points that lie on this side of hyperplane, they are positive, and all the points on this side of the hyperplane, they are negative. Then I would have been able to classify these points with 100% accuracy. Okay. So basically, I want to learn this W, that is normal to my hyperplane as well as B, rather than fixing them. Here, in this classifier, I have fixed them. So I fixed W to B twice mu plus minus mu minus, right? And I have fixed B to be mu minus square minus mu plus square. But I don't want to do that, let's say. I want to learn them. Now, naturally, I'll make my classifier more expensive to train. This is like the simplest possible thing to do, right? Just take your points, average them out. You have your classifier, but it will be limited in power. Okay. Okay. So now the question is, can we learn them efficiently, and are there good algorithms to do that? And answer is yes, but with some caveats. So let's look at one such algorithm. It's called perceptron. Let me get rid of all this. So I think perceptron is one of the most celebrated algorithm in learning, maybe more celebrated than even k-nearest neighbors, which is So, and it was discovered, I think, in 1958 by Rosenblatt. He was a neurobiologist, and he was looking at it from some, like, classifying some brain signals or something like that. So that's why he named it perceptron. And it has been very influential in development of several areas of machine learning. So neural networks are a more complicated form of perceptron in some sense. They essentially use multiple perceptrons in multiple layers. And SVMs is also, a bit of modification of perceptron. And then there are several such algorithms. So this is like one of the most singular, like most important algorithm. So let's consider the setting. So suppose I have a bunch of points, training points, okay? And my goal is now to learn this predictor function, W inner product to the X plus B. That is this hyperplane with normal W and distance to origin B. And this I like, just for ease of notation, I'll just write it as W inner product with X, where I have extended X as X1, okay? And W is now my WB, okay? It's just a notational thing. Okay, so I want to learn this classifier, that is, I want to learn W given these training points, okay? So perceptron, what it does is it proceeds in multiple iterations. So initially, let's say it will assign W equals 0. Okay, and let's also note one more thing, that is, if I scale a point, that is, if I scale x point xi to xi by 2 norm of xi, it doesn't change its fx, right? The same w will give exactly the same sign even later. So this is equal to sine of w comma xi, right? So I can assume that each xi is scaled to norm 1, okay? So here I will have each xi is in r to power d, and 2 norm of xi is equal to 1, okay? So initially, so the algorithm is the following. So in the first step, I'll set my W to be 0, okay? Then for, let's say, T is equal to 1 onwards, like to, let's say, to N, although it need not go to N, basically till convergence. And then I see that, okay, if my existing solution, that is, W trans times XT times YT is less than equal to 0, then I do an update, that is W is equal to W plus YT XT. Okay, and this ends here, this ends here, and then I'll output W. Okay. So let's see what this algorithm is doing. So initially my W is 0. What I do is, at each step, I consider point xt and yt, and I compute W inner product with xt times yt. Okay. So if my current classifier W represents my current classifier, if my current classifier is predicting correctly for xt, that is, if sine of W comma xt is equal to yt, then this product will be greater than or equal to 0, right? So in that case, I don't change my classifier at all. It says that, okay, since my classifier is already good, I don't need to change it. But if my classifier predicts incorrectly on this point, then what I'll do is I'll update my classifier. And this is the update rule. It's like the one of the most simplest update rule you can think of, right? Just add that point weighted by its sign, okay? And just do it for all your training points and output W. Okay. Exactly.
XTs are normalized here.
XTs are normalized. So I'm assuming that each XT is norm 1 because XTs don't, like norm of XTs doesn't have any bearing on the W here in this case. Okay?
Is it assumed that YTs are always ±1
throughout the lecture? Yeah, throughout this lecture we'll assume that YTs are ±1. Later we'll capture, we'll consider multi-class algorithms where you can have multiple classes. Here I'm just assuming positive classes, positive labels and negative labels. So the algorithm is clear. So the question is this algorithm any good? What can we say by this algorithm? Will it really find a hyperplane that can linearly separate my data points? Okay. So naturally, like as Prateek earlier said that if my data points are not linearly separable, that is, let's say if they are positives and then negatives like this, okay, then I don't have any hyperplane that can separate these points, that can separate positives from negatives. So in that case, anyways, like this algorithm cannot do anything. But suppose if my points are separable, that is, let's say these are my positive points, these are my negative points, and there is a hyperplane which can separate it. That is, there exists some W star, okay? There exists some W star such that 2 norm of W star, let's say, is 1, okay? And I want a little bit of separation or margin for this W star. Okay, that is, what I require is that every point should be, let's say, at least gamma distance away from this hyperplane. Okay, so gamma is any arbitrary number. So given my points which are linearly separable, gamma is essentially min over all I x I comma W star Y. Okay. So this is my margin. So intuitively, this margin represents how hard it is to separate these points out. So if your points are really far away in space, that is, if you have a situation like this, if your points are really, really far away in space, then you will have, like, it would be very easy to find a hyperplane, right? Intuitively, that's what should happen, right? But if my points are very close by and the margin is very small, so let's say if these are positive points, these are negative points, then finding this hyperplane will be very hard, the separating hyperplane. And that's what this quantity will quantify in our analysis. Okay, so this gamma is my margin, which is essentially for my linear, like optimal linearly, not optimal, but my true separator, or at least one of the true separators, for one of the true separator, minimum distance of any point xi to the hyperplane. Okay. So now, what can we claim theoretically? So claim is the following, that perceptron algorithm will find W star, that is, it will find the true linear separator after at most 1 by gamma square mistakes. Okay. So yeah, I'll explain. So note that here this is one mistake that my algorithm does. So whenever W misclassifies XTYT, That is one mistake. Okay. And now this algorithm, what it is saying is that if you do 1 by gamma square mistakes, that is, if your algorithm does this update 1 by gamma square times, then you will obtain your true separator W star. Okay?
Is the W star maximum margin?
No, it is not. W star is just one of the separator, but you will find one of the separators in 1 by gamma square after 1 by gamma square steps. Okay? So surely, I mean, W star need not be unique, but I'll find one of these guys for sure. Okay? And which one I find will depend on in what sequence I am giving the points. Is the claim clear?
So Pradeek, is there anything about the error?
There is no error here. What I can guarantee is that after these many steps, I will find exact W star. I mean, one of the, so W star is now in some sense a set for me. I'll find one of the separator W star. Only if the data is linearly separable. Furthermore, I have some margin. Just linear separability is not enough for me. I need some margin. Yeah, so we'll see the proof. Yeah, there will always be margin, but that margin can be sometimes exponentially small. Let's say the margin is something like e to power minus d. Then this mistake bound is not very good, because then that says that I'll need exponentially many points in my dimensionality. Okay. So basically this gamma specifies how tough your problem is. And if your problem is very tough, then the running time of your algorithm and the number of examples that it requires, both of them will be very high. Okay? So let's look at the proof. So let's consider our Tth step. So after Tth step, my iterate, I'll call it to be Wt. Okay? And let's say in Tth step, my classifier made a mistake. Okay, that is, there is an update. That is, Wt is equal to Wt minus 1 plus Xt Yt. Okay? Tth step is this. And also, let's say that till Tth step, algorithm made capital M mistakes. Okay. Till the Tth step, I made some M mistakes. Naturally, M is less than equal to T. Okay. So the proof proceeds in two parts. First part, proof shows that my Wt dot W star, that is inner product of Wt and W star, which sort of says the similarity of Wt and W star, is large enough, like it is greater than something like m times gamma. Okay. In the second part of proof, shows that my norm of Wt is not very large. This is less than equal to something like m. Okay. And from that, we'll conclude that the total number of, like, maximum number of mistakes that we'll make will be 1 by gamma square. Okay. So let me first prove the first claim. So let's look at this inner product Wt, comma W star. So that is equal to, so let's replace Wt is Wt minus 1 plus Xt Yt times W star. And that is equal to inner product of Wt minus 1 with W star plus Yt inner product of xt comma w star, right? Is that clear? This is simple. And this quantity I know is for sure greater than gamma. What is gamma? Gamma, let me define gamma here. Gamma is min over all I yi w star comma xi, right? So this quantity is definitely greater than gamma. So that's why my wt inner product w star is greater than equal to wt minus 1 comma w star plus gamma, okay? So every time I make a mistake, I increase WT inner product with W star by gamma. Now I said that till Tth step I made m mistakes, okay? And in the first step my W is equal to 0. So in first step my inner product will be 0, okay? So I know for sure that this thing will be greater than equal to m times gamma, right? Okay, so first part of the proof is done. Now let's look at WT square. So WT square is equal to, so again replace WT by this. So WT minus 1 plus XT YT square. Okay, and that is equal to WT minus 1 square plus YT square XT square plus twice inner product of WT minus 1 with XT weighted by YT. Okay. Is that clear? Now YT square will always be equal to 1 because YT is either plus 1 or minus 1. XT I have already assumed is XT's 2 norm is always 1. So this number is 1. Okay. And let's look at this number. So this is what? This is essentially yt times my prediction on xt. And we know that by our algorithm, this thing is less than equal to 0. I made a mistake in tth step. So wt minus 1 must have predicted incorrectly on point xt. And that's why this quantity is less than equal to 0. This quantity is equal to 1. So that's why this whole quantity is less than equal to wt minus 1 square plus 1, okay? And now again, I know that, okay, I made at most m mistakes till tth step, and initially, like, my 2 norm was 0. So that's why this thing will be less than equal to m, okay? So wt square is less than equal to m, that's why wt 2 norm is less than equal to root m, okay? And now using these two quantities or these two claims, I'll show that our algorithm will make at most 1 by gamma square mistakes. How do we do that? Very simple. We know that by Cauchy-Shaw's, Cauchy-Shaw's inequality. Inner product of WT with W star is less than equal to 2 norm of WT times 2 norm of W star, right? 2 norm of W star is 1. And 2 norm of WT I have shown is less than equal to root M. So that's why this quantity is less than root M, okay? And furthermore, I have shown that WT inner product W star is greater than equal to M times gamma, right? Is that clear? This follows from Cauchy-Shaw's. This follows from claim number 2. This follows from claim number 1. Right? And what does this say? This will imply that m gamma is less than equal to root m. That is, root m is less than equal to 1 by gamma. That is, m is less than equal to 1 by gamma square. So my number of mistakes at any step t will always be less than or equal to 1 by gamma square. So Cauchy-Schwarz inequality says that if I have two vectors p and q in r to power d, then inner product of pq is always less than or equal to 2 norm of p, 2 norm of q. That is summation over all I, pi qi is less than or equal to root of summation pi square, summation qi square. This inequality, so yeah, here you have two norm, but there is something called Holder's inequality. Okay, which says that, okay, inner product of P and Q is less than equal to, let me use L1, L2, where L1 and L2 are conjugate norms. That is 1 by L1 plus 1 by L2 is equal to 1. Okay. So for example, if L1 is infinity, then L2 is 1. And we know that L1 is 2, then L2 also has to be 2. So it holds for several of these conjugate norms. Conjugate norms are basically that satisfy this condition. Okay. So anyway, so coming back here, is this proof clear? So in this proof, what we are showing is that at each step, our inner product with W star is increasing, and at the same time, two norm of our matrix is not increasing by too much. Okay, and that's why overall, like in time, we will catch up with W star, and that time essentially is this 1 by gamma square steps or 1 by gamma square mistakes. Okay, and intuitively, what it says is that, okay, if your margin of your W star is very small, that is, if your points are very close to hyperplane, then you will require many more samples or many more examples to figure out correct hyperplane, okay, which is also fairly intuitive. All right, shall we proceed? Cool. So now let's look at the decision function that this guy throws up. Can I get rid of the proof? So remember, like we said, that fx is and we are learning W by using this perceptron algorithm. And if you look at W, how does it look? W looks like summation over alpha I y or alpha t y t x t, right? It is always adding this y t x t to W. So at the end of, let's say, n steps, this is how my W will look, right? Where alpha t is 0 if my wt minus 1 inner product with xt, yt was positive, and alpha t is equal to 1 otherwise. Right? That is, whether I made an update or not, alpha t is an indicator of that. And if I made an update, then I added yt xt, and if I didn't make any update, then obviously this term is 0. Okay? So let's look at the let's look at fx in that case. So this looks like sine of summation alpha t yt xt inner product with x. Okay. So this decision function is only dependent on the inner products. Inner product of my point x, my test point x with my training points, right? It doesn't use my training point XTs in any other manner. They are just used to compute inner product of XT with X. Is clear? And this information or this observation can be exploited, and it is exploited in machine learning like big time, and it has given rise to this big area called kernel algorithms or kernel based algorithms or kernel trick. And basic idea is just this, that there are algorithms, there are several machine learning algorithms that only needs to compute inner product of your test point with this training point. They do not use your training point in any other manner. Okay? They are just used as inner product. So now what you can think of is that, okay, rather than just XT, I can maybe map this XT to some other feature space, something which is better for me or something that has more information for me. And now what I can do is I can rewrite this fx as sine of summation alpha t y t phi of xt with phi of x. Right? And now, again, this is the only thing that I worry about is, so I don't need to worry about how big this phi is or not. So this mapping is what? This mapping is r to power d to, let's say, r to power phi. Okay? And this phi can be very large, let's say, or let me call it d phi. This d phi can be even, let's say, infinite. I don't really care, because I am using these phi xt's only as inner product. As long as I can compute this inner product efficiently, I don't care what is the dimensionality of this phi. Okay. Now, so this is like, okay, we know that, okay, you have this power. You can map your points xt to a very high dimensional space. As long as you can compute the inner product efficiently, you are happy. But why do you want to do that? What is the need for that? So as was pointed out earlier, that suppose your points are not linearly separable, can you do anything so that you can still use this very nice perceptron algorithm? Okay? And answer is yes. In certain cases, you can definitely do it. So suppose, you know, let's consider a case where you have several positive points here. Let me call this as So consider two-dimensional case, x1, x2, this is my origin. So I have a positive point at 1, 1, I have a negative point at 1, minus 1, I have a positive point at minus 1, minus 1, and I have a negative point at minus 1, 1. Okay? I have 4 points. These 2 are negative points, they are diagonally across, and these 2 are positive points. And we know for sure that there does not exist any hyperplane that will separate these points. There is no way you can do that. Right? So the question is, can you go to some other space and make them separable? And answer is yes. So if you consider this mapping of your points x1, x2 to a space like x1 square, x2 square, root 2 x1, x2, then I claim that these points are linearly separable. Let's look at the reason why. So I can get rid of this. So let's look at this point. This point gets mapped to, let me call them. So let's say this is point A, this is point B, this is point C, which is minus 1, minus 1, and then this is point D. So I know that my point A, which was 1, 1, gets mapped to 1, 1, root 2. My point B, which was 1, minus 1, gets mapped to 1, 1, minus root 2. Similarly, my point C, which was minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, that gets mapped to 1, 1, root 2, my point D, which is minus 1, 1, that gets mapped to 1, 1, minus root 2. Okay. Now, like, you know, you can directly see, right, that A and C are basically mapped to exactly same point in your three-dimensional space. And B and D are also mapped to exactly same point in your three-dimensional space. Okay? So this mapping separates out your points. And that is typically the idea behind these kernel methods. What they'll do is take your whatever dimensional feature space you have and map it to a much dimensional, much higher dimensional feature space. And they will hope that in the higher dimensional space, your data points will become linearly separable. Although even in original space, they might not be linearly separable, but in higher dimensional space, they will be linearly separable. So let's take another example that Pritesh suggested. So let's say I have positives here, okay, and negatives here, okay. So let's say this is a circle with radius 1, and this is a circle with radius 2, okay. So then when I do this mapping of x1 square, x2 square, root 2, x1, x2, x2. Let's just, I mean, forget about the third dimension. Just let's look at the first two dimensions of my phi. So this is, let's say, phi 1, this is phi 2 dimension. And let's even forget about phi 3 dimension. But just in phi 2 dimension, phi 1 and phi 2 dimensions, I know that x1 square plus x2 square is 1 for all the positives. So all my positives will lie on this line, right? And all my negatives will lie on this line, right? So, and then there is a third dimension, which is just, so all the positives will lie in this hyperplane, which is perpendicular to these two axes, and all the negatives will lie in hyperplane, which is perpendicular to this board, right? And we know that any hyperplane which is sort of perpendicular to the board and is between these two guys, will linearly separate these points. So although these points were not linearly separable, but I was able to map them into another space and make them linearly separable. Okay. So feature mapping is very critical. You can try several features. So suppose you are given a data set, you don't know what to do with it. What you can do is you can just tinker with the data, like just, you know, change your features a little bit, take their square, multiply some of them, and who knows, you might find a good linearly separable hyperplane. Okay, so that's fine. Now, what if, like as I said earlier, that what if the phi space where you go, which has d phi dimensionality, if it is too very high dimensional, you might not be able to compute it efficiently. You might not be able to compute this inner product efficiently because inner product takes order d phi time. So what you want is that you should be able to, there should be some function which will compute this inner product efficiently. And those are what called kernel functions. So kernel functions are essentially functions of your low dimensional feature space that computes inner products in a very high dimensional space. Okay. So for example, let's look at this phi, this mapping. So I know that phi x comma phi y or phi z, let's say, for this particular mapping will look like summation, or my summation, x1 square z1 square plus x2 square z2 square plus twice x1 x2 z1 z2. And this I can write as x1 z1 plus x2 z2 whole square. This is essentially inner product of x comma z to the power right? So although the mapping is in three-dimensional space, still I was able to compute it by inner product in this just two-dimensional space and then taking its square, right? And in fact, I can construct a similarly even more complicated mapping. That is, what I can do is I can construct a mapping such that phi x comma phi z is equal to inner product of x comma z to the power d. Okay, so the feature space mapping for this will be something like pi over I1 I2 till id, like any general. Let me just write any general coordinate I1 I2 till id such that summation of these ij's is equal to d, and I will have x to the power I1. I should not write like this. X to the power I1, x1 to the power I1, x to the power I2, and so on till xt to the power id, where summation of these ij's, j goes from 1 to d, is equal to d. So you can see that, like, the number of how many such I1, I2 till id can I pick up? You can pick up essentially something like at least order 2 to power d. Not order, but it is much more actually. Okay. So your feature dimension, so this phi x, that is your high dimensional feature space, is exponential in your original dimensionality d. Okay. But you are still able to compute the inner product in how much time? Just order d time. Right? You're computing inner product of these points, which are in d dimension, in d time, and then you just take it to some power. And that essentially computes inner product of these phi's, which are in order 2 to power d dimensions. Okay. Actually, it should be d to power d. So, and basically you will take them to this higher dimensional space with the hope that in the higher dimensional space, your data points are linearly separable. Because when you project up your data points, they tend to separate out. And that's the whole idea. Okay? So, any questions? Yeah.
Is it just a hope or is there any
demo? Just a hope. You cannot say anything other than that. I mean, you can, this mapping function, what you can do is you can write summation xi zi to the power d and then take this expansion.
Why are we limiting ourselves to a linear separator?
Because for linear separators, we know good algorithms. We know, for example, this perceptron algorithm, which is very efficient. We can analyze it. We can understand it well. When you go to non-linear classifiers, things become very tricky. And I mean, so only successful nonlinear classifiers, I think, are basically neural networks and decision trees. And people don't understand them that well. And they are prone to overfitting. Like sometimes what you can do is you can supply too much of nonlinearity to your function. And it might end up overfitting arbitrarily to your test data, sorry, training data, which you don't want. So for example, I mean, in fact, sorry, k-nearest neighbor is also a nonlinear classifier. So suppose I have some points, positive points here, and I have some negative points here. What this classifier can probably do is it can learn decision boundaries of this type. The nonlinear classifier. Mm-hmm. I didn't draw it properly. I should have drawn it another way. Let's say these are negative points. And these are positive points. Okay, so what can happen is basically it can draw some very non-linear curves, which are essentially just overfitting to the data, which essentially say that, okay, if you see this data point, assign it a positive label. Okay, And you don't want that because your data can be, your data collection process can be noisy. The test data that you see might be somewhat related to your training data, but it need not be exactly the, your training data. So in that case, you want some good generalization properties. Your algorithm should be able to generalize good to new test points. And that will happen if your model is simple. If your model is too complicated, your generalization ability will taper off. Yeah. Yeah, so expansion of dimension will allow you to get a nonlinear classifier, but you can still understand that nonlinear classifier up to some extent because you are learning it through a linear classifier only. So one, the algorithm will still be efficient. You can say that, okay, it will converge in this much of time and blah, blah. And furthermore, I mean, if you assume some properties in your high dimensional space, you can still guarantee that, okay, if you see these many examples, then I can guarantee you that on test points, you will not get any error. So those type of properties you can still analyze. Okay. So one option, I mean, there are two options, right? So one option is that learn a nonlinear classifier in your original feature space, or go to a nonlinear feature space and learn a linear classifier there. And so far what people have seen is that the second approach seems to be a little bit more promising because you have good algorithms to do that and you understand those algorithms a little bit better. In this, in the first regime of nonlinear classifiers, there are three super popular algorithms, k-nearest neighbor, neural networks, and decision trees. And I mean, they have been successful in several applications, but main criticism that is leveled against all these three algorithms is that nobody understands them properly. Theoretically, they are still very, and you can get some very weird results using those classifiers on certain data sets. Any other question? Okay, so let me just recap. So basically, we studied two algorithms. First was simple mean-based algorithm. Compute mean of your positives, compute mean of your negatives. And if a point is close to positives, just assign it a positive label. Okay, and then we saw that the decision boundary of such a classifier is essentially a hyperplane, but where the normal to the hyperplane as well as the bias of the hyperplane is fixed. So we said that, okay, we don't want to do that. We want to learn normal to the hyperplane as well. And for that, we looked at perceptron algorithm, which is amazingly simple update algorithm. Like the algorithm is extremely simple, efficient, easy to implement. And we saw that you can analyze that algorithm very well also. That is, if your data point is indeed linearly separable, then and it has some margin gamma, then 1 by gamma square mistakes or 1 by gamma square updates, you will be done. You will obtain a linear separator. Okay? And then we looked at very briefly at this issue of feature space mapping, that if your original feature space is not linearly separable, you can go to some higher dimensional feature space without losing out much on your computational advantage or computational speed. But you can hope that in higher dimensional space, you will have good separability. So this issue will again come back to during where we study support vector machines later. Okay, all right, thanks. Okay, so Praneet, any questions there?